Hello everyone, today we talk about the Green Devils and propaganda. And for this we have the curator of the exhibition on the Fallschirmjäger, Dr. Magnus Pahl. Hello. And we're at the Military History Museum of the Bundeswehr in Dresden. So there are several aspects about the Green Devils when it comes to propaganda. The most interesting aspect you told me previously is that they were used against England to a certain degree.
Yes, that's right. After the capitulation of France in June 1940, the Germans prepared to invade England. Of course, the operation so-called Unternehmen Seelöwe, Sea Lion. And the precondition, prerequisite was to gain the air superiority over Great Britain and especially over England, south of England. And the German Luftwaffe was not able
to achieve it
because in the Battle of Britain there were some defeats and backsettings and so on and so on. And that was not fulfilled. The precondition was not fulfilled, and so they were not able to go over a certain stage of planning, the operation. And that was to a certain degree clear to the regime, but the propaganda minister Joseph Goebbels tried to keep the British population, the British army, on a state of awareness and destabilization. And so he used the parachute troops, which were successful in the Netherlands and in Belgium, we talked about eben Emal, and he used them as some kind of threat to the British island. And he also worked close together with the Air Force, and they used, for example, dummies. Goebbels wrote that down in his diary, in the Goebbels diaries. And they put over London and the London area dummies, and the British Home Security Service and so on and so on at the home front. We're always on a certain state of alert because of this threat of German paratroopers. And yes, Goebbels continued to use them as some kind of propaganda tool machine. Even only a few weeks before the attack on the Soviet Union, because the Germans always tried to make deception operation to hide that they are planning to attack the Soviet Union. They tried to hide the build-up of German forces in Poland and in occupied parts of Poland and in the east. And Goebbels took part in a deception operation, and according to the sources, it was his own idea. Soon after the capture of Crete in May, June 41, he wrote an article in a leading newspaper, and it was called Kreta als Beispiel, Crete as an example. And more or less Goebbels wrote in his own article that paratroopers were able to capture an island by themselves. So, and that of course was crystal clear for everyone that England was the next target for parachute forces. And that was only a deception, and he organized it in the way that some of those newspapers were already printed. And shortly after delivery, some police forces and so on in Berlin at the capital captured and
retrieved the these examples.
Retrieved the examples, and but they had secure that that or they
made sure
they made sure that some especially some neutral states or embassies were able to took copies of the special newspaper with the article from Goebbels. And so that was the idea behind, okay, that was our fault to deliver such newspapers, and now we try to get it back. And that was only for deception, only to calm down the Soviet side.
Now, another aspect from what I read is, in which is the Fascism a bit similar to the Waffen-SS, they got their own propaganda companies. So generally, the German army used propaganda companies, which they saw actually as combat troops to a certain degree, which followed the troops around. I think for Operation Barbarossa, you had about one company for each army. And I know for the army and the Waffen-SS, there was quite some jealousy because on the Eastern Front, the portrayal was that the Waffen-SS was not so numerous at that time sometimes, but was way more often in the news due to a higher number of propaganda companies. And the Fallschirmjäger were a rather small force as well, and they got their own propaganda companies or one. What was the setup here?
In Crete, in May 1941, actually it was a platoon, but their own platoon, the private troops, had the 11th Flieger Corps, it was the code name, the Fallschirm Corps, Parachute Corps, and they had their own war correspondence. And yes, of course, their main task was to set the own branch of arms, the own Waffengattung, in a positive light. That was the basic idea, to make real-time photos and film material and to draw a picture of victorious and superior fighters, and so they had their own war correspondence, and that was a kind of feature for elite forces. So that was unique, because you mentioned it above, that the ordinary infantry division or tank divisions did not have their own war correspondence.
And I think especially for Monte Cassino, it played a role, because there they were in the spotlight of the fighting, whereas other units like the 15th Panzer Grenadier Division were not so much. And there was some envy and resentment on the army side.
Yes, that's true, because I think that's also why there's much more photo material, even until now, from parachuters fighting in Cassino than from different units, for example, mountain troops, Panzergrenadiere, infantry divisions, and you have more photos about paratroops, and that's of course an effect, because they had more direct reporting, and the material was often used in the Wochenschau as well. And I found some sources that even the paratroopers who were not engaged in the fighting in periods of refit and so on, and in their leisure time in the hinterland, they watched the Wochenschau and were always, of course, happy to see themselves or comrades on the newsreel, on the Wochenschau. And you have some effects that paratroopers, because of that, because this reason, tried to be part of the Wochenschau, of the picture. And if there were camera teams filming some actions in Monte Cassino, in Cassino area, we have reports that the paratroopers were even not so aware of their own security and risk more than usual, because they wanted to be filmed in quite proper proper conditions and attacking, for example, and they risk more than they usually would have done.
Of course, it's important to note that not all footage you see of fighting is real fighting, sometimes it's staged, sometimes you can tell, sometimes you can't. And I think I read in your book particularly there was one instance that a paratrooper, I think, returned to the front, but met an army unit or an army officer, and he said basically take a hike to your own troops because he was like, he was really angry about them in a certain way.
Yeah, some kind of jealous, because the propaganda is staged, especially the paratroopers. And the infantrymen, the grenadiers, were not staged in this high level like the paratroopers. They were favored, of course, by the propaganda. And I think that's also the reason, because they looked very stylish. They were better. It was better to film a young paratrooper without spectacles and without, I don't know, not old ones, but the young ones with the stylish and fancy new equipment, uniforms.
And also slightly different helmet, yeah.
Different helmet, different camouflage smock, sometimes different weapons, for example, the Fallschirmjägergewehr 42. And that's why they were depicted as models for filming.
There was one final connection, if I remember correctly. Goebbels had a family relative or step relative, I don't know how you'd say that, in the unit?
Stepson, yeah. Yeah. Harald Quandt was his name. And, we also, again, we have to go back to the early times of the National Socialist Party. Goebbels was, before 1933, the so-called Gauleiter of Berlin. He was in charge for party, as a party governor for the district of Berlin, and worked close together with the stormtroopers, with the SA, Sturmabteilung, because those were the guys who protected him as a high Nazi politician, especially against the communists, which were fighting against the National Socialists. And there was a close relation between Goebbels and the former Berlin or the Berlin stormtroopers, the SA. And in 1938, 39, Göring used the SA Guard Regiment, was called Feldherrnhalle, in quotation marks, Feldherrnhalle, and put it into his airborne force as well. And so you have the regiment, the SA, Stormtroopers Regiment, as part of the paratroop division.
The core unit,
The core unit for Fallschirmjägerregiment 2, Parachute Regiment 2. And so from those early days on, Goebbels was very keen and very familiar also with the paratroops, because he knew some of them from the former days in the stormtroops.
Alte Kämpfer.
Some kind of alte Kämpfer. And you know, the concept of the stormtroopers were were the same like the SS, because the SS, of course, came from the stormtroopers, from the SA, Sturmabteilung, originally. And they had the idea to be political soldiers, politische Soldaten. Of course, in the sense of National Socialist ideas, socialist, National Socialist, political soldiers for Hitler. And I think that's maybe the main reason why Goebbels' stepson, Harald Quandt, joined the paratroopers and not, for example, the Leibstandarte of the SS, because in Goebbels' eyes, it was on the same level. They were both National Socialist units, very reliable, loyal towards Hitler and Göring, and also the regime, Goebbels, of course. And Harald Quandt joined the paratroopers, and he took part in Operation Mercury, Merkur in Crete, May 1941, and also later on during the fightings in Italy and also in Monte Cassino. And that is also a very close link, because even Hitler knew Harald Quandt very well. His mother was Magda Goebbels, Joseph Goebbels' wife. and she was also a friend of Hitler. And so Hitler was very interested in Harald on a personal level. And I found that at the Goebbels' diary again as well, that the division commander of 1st Parachute Division, 1. Fallschirmjägerdivision, and Goebbels had letters contact.
Personal correspondence,
So personal correspondence. And that's quite, of course, unique in the Wehrmacht, because you had many hundred different divisions in the Wehrmacht. That was only one division, only a division, divisional commander. And nevertheless, he was able to write directly to Goebbels. And Goebbels in return sent, for example, cigars, cognac, and so on to the divisional commander of the 1st Fallschirmjägerdivision during the battle at Cassino. And that shows the close ties between the regime and the 1st Parachute Division, 1st Fallschirmjägerdivision.
So basically, the Fallschirmjäger were collected to the highest levels or highest echelon of the Third Reich.
Yeah.
Okay, I hope you got a better understanding on how the Green Devils were actually integrated in the whole system of the Third Reich. Thank you very much. And thank you for watching and see you next time. Bye.